No weapon formed against me shall prosper. It won't work.
Greetings once again in the name of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. It is with great pleasure that I come to discourse with you one more time on principles and advice and counsel enshrined in the Word of God that would encourage us to be able to live to please the Lord, and especially in these days where there is so much crime, so much evil, we realize that we seem to be in the last days. Let's pray. Almighty God, once again we thank you for the opportunity to share the Word of God with each other. Holy Spirit, take complete control as I speak. Let me say just what you want me to say, that some hearer would be encouraged, would be brought from a depth of despair, would be delivered from the hands of the enemy, would have strength to carry on, would turn their lives from sin to you, O God, would turn the life from darkness to light, will accept Jesus Christ as their Savior and repent of their sins, O God. Let the hearers be enlightened today and find strength, salvation, and grace in you. In the name of your Son, Jesus Christ, I pray. Amen. Today I'm looking at advice for living in these last days. Godly advice for living. And my scripture is from 1 Thessalonians chapter 5. I'll go through that chapter and we'll see how the Apostle Paul encouraged and advised and counseled the Thessalonians in those days that they should continue serving God no matter what, because in his day they felt that things were bad. But if they had lived to be in this time, this 21st century, what would they have said? So many murders, so many killings, so much human trafficking. I mean, we've had the extermination of the Jews and how many things happened to Africans who came, the slaves who came from Africa to colonize this place, the West Indies and other places, other countries. But like, mankind has been determined by evil to be more evil to other people than ever in the world. They have designed so many other ways of being evil to each other, but we are encouraged that in these last days, godly advice, we have godly advice for living. It says here from verse 4, he said, "Now, brethren, about times and dates," from the NIV version, "we do not need to write to you, for you know very well that the day of the Lord will come like a thief in the night." That is the return of the Lord Jesus Christ. He said he is gone to prepare a place for us, and he'll come again. And people scoff and say, "Oh, so many thousands of years he's gone and he hasn't returned." But God's timing is not like man's timing. One day with the Lord is as 1,000 years, and 1,000 years is one day. So he says he's going to return, and in the fullness of his own time, he'll return. God will send him back to redeem the world, when he's going to destroy this earth and have a new earth because of sin caused by Satan and those who rebelled against God. And if we choose not to follow God, we will suffer the same fate like Satan and those rebellious angels. So he says, "For you well know that the day of the Lord will come as a thief in the night. While people are saying peace and safety, Destruction will come on them suddenly as labor pains on a pregnant woman, and they will not escape. So we are being admonished here and being advised here to be watchful. And he says to us that you who know Jesus Christ as their Savior, you who have turned to the Lord, you are not in darkness. So at this day should surprise you like a thief. He says you are all of sons of God and sons of the light, sons of the day. We do not belong to the night or to the darkness. So let us not be like others who are asleep, but let us be alert and self-controlled. So God is advised, the word of God is advising us here, in these last days, we ought to be alert and have self-control. He said, for those who sleep, sleep at night, and those who get drunk at night. But he said, those who have accepted Christ, we do not belong to the day. We belong to the day, not to the night. Let us be self-controlled, putting on faith and love as a breastplate and the hope of salvation as a helmet. So, to protect us, our heart, and our vital organs from the enemy, we need to have faith in God and love for God and man. And that forms for us a breastplate of protection. You know, soldier goes out to fight and they used to have this breastplate that will protect, that when the spear is thrown, it will not go and pierce through their bodies and kill them. So they had that like an armor, a breastplate they call it. So if the spear was thrown and they threw it at them, it wouldn't penetrate their bodies, it would bounce off. So we have to put on, in this case, love, faith and love. Faith, what is faith? Faith is believing in the Lord Jesus Christ, believing in God, believing that what God has said in his word is going to come to pass. Because we have proof in the word of God and proof among us that whatever God has said to his prophets over the years, they have come to pass. The birth of Jesus Christ was predicted, and it came to pass in its time and season, just as it was predicted by those prophets of old. No matter how long it took, Isaiah, all those guys down there, those old men, they died and they did not see Jesus Christ come and die on the cross, but God predicted it. His prophets prophesied it, and it did happen. And if those events did happen, what prevents the other events from happening? So Jesus Christ is going to be returning for the people of God someday soon. We don't know. When we die, our day has come. So whether we live or die, we ought to be self-controlled and put on faith and love as a breastplate. And you must have the hope of salvation. Whatever you want, you hope for, you can get it. Salvation comes through Jesus Christ. We were born in sin and shaped in iniquity. And God sent his only son, Jesus Christ, to die for us. Every man, boy, girl, child, needs salvation through Jesus Christ. And if we're born, we live and we die, and we never ever consider that we are born in sin, and we do sinful things, we did sinful things, and we never saw the need to repent of our sins and ask God to forgive us and change our ways, then when we die, we can't go to be with God. We'll have to be away from him with the dead and his angels who introduced sin into the Garden of Eden, because they caused Adam to disobey God. Satan wanted to make himself like God. So he said, I'm going to try to destroy what God has made. But the first man, Adam, sinned. And Jesus Christ, the second man, the second Adam came. And he died a sinless soul. He lived and he died and he rose again. And he took the sacrifice up to him and said, Father, I have paid the price for mankind. Now, thank you, I've done it already. I paid the price. And if you consider the price that was paid for our salvation by Jesus' living here, his suffering, his humiliation, what they did to him on that cross, he was in agony, he died. You couldn't pay the price for your sin. But God sent his only son, Jesus Christ. So we have a way of salvation through Jesus Christ. So he says in verse 11, verse 9, for God did not appoint us to suffer wrath, but to receive salvation through our Lord Jesus Christ. So that is God's plan for mankind, that we get salvation through Jesus Christ. So because Christ died for us, so that whether we are asleep or wake or die, we may live together with him. So we are supposed to encourage one another, build up each other, and encourage each other to live for God, to walk in love, to walk in forgiveness, to turn away from our sins, turn away from our evil ways. Don't be caught up by the evil that is around us. Everybody is stealing, you don't have to steal. Everybody is joining a gang, you don't have to join a gang. You give your life to the Lord Jesus Christ. Go by yourself and accept the Lord as his personal Savior. Because you know you're born in sin. The very nature in you that propels you towards evil can tell you that you were born in sin and shaped in iniquity. But God made a way out for us through his son Jesus Christ. So we have been admonished here and advised here to live holy. Sometimes he said, they don't seem to recognize those people who work hard among us. Believers, those who have accepted Christ, God has set shepherds over you, leaders over you. And there's always a hierarchy of leadership, just as in the natural, so in the spiritual. And we have to be able to honor those who God has set over us. Pray for them. We're not going to worship them as God, but we'll have respect for them, we'll honor them, we'll do right by them according to principles enshrined in the Word of God. We'll not walk every day and speak our leadership. If our leader makes a mistake, who told you that your leader in this lifetime would never make a mistake? The enemy for our souls is always the tempter, so people will make mistakes. But the fact is that once they realize that they've made a mistake and they've sinned and they've done wrong, and they are truly repentant and go back to God and ask God for forgiveness, God is a God of love and forgiveness. He looks on the heart of man. He sees what he sees deep down. What is your desire? Are you desirous of really serving God? Are you desirous of really walking in the truth and the right pathways? If God sees that in your heart, he understands your flaws and your failures. And once you go to him in heartfelt repentance, God forgive us. Our God is a Sakai for forgiveness until he says time shall be no more. He'll forgive you. Man may not forgive you, but God will forgive you and give you another chance, because Jesus Christ paid the price for all of us. So we admonish here again, we advise here that we must respect those who labor above us, our leaders, and our leaders also in government. We don't have to do the wrong things that some people do, but there's a way you can give them the respect that is due for the position they hold. Because not everyone is called to lead a country, to lead a village, to lead a nation. Everyone doesn't have that capability. Same thing in the old scriptures, in the Old Testament, they had kings, leaders, rulers. And you have to just follow the law of the land, do the right thing. So So we should hold them in highest regard in love because of their work, especially in the gospel's sake. We are encouraged here also to live in peace with each other. Live in peace with each other, oh my Lord. There are some people, some nations, people who are always fighting, killing another. Look at these other doctrines that they go around, killing people in churches, in synagogues, and killing people. Why all of that? That's pure hate. We are supposed to love one another and live in peace with each other. God has placed each of us upon this earth to live on. You have your space. The other guy have his space. Give the other person their space. Who made you judge and executioner to go about and kill these people? You are not God. You are just mere man like all of us. So we ought to live. Those people out there who are committing crime, who are killing people and find, well, this one did them something and they are executing them. This one did that. It's not right in the sight of God. And the thing is that you execute and kill people and you are still around and alive that you can still repent of your sin. That's so unfair. But God is in control of all. He knows exactly what is happening to each one. So we exhort you to live in peace with each other. And it says in verse 14, we urge you, brothers, to warn those who are idle. Warn those who are idle. We have idlers among us. There are people who don't want to work for a living. They would sit down and chat and lie for the whole day, and they would not go out to look for a fruitful job. They sponge on others. They steal, they rob, they kill for them to live after somebody else has put out hard work. Each human being is expected to work and not be idle. Don't plan to kill and to steal. People sit and plot, they plot great plots to steal these millions of dollars, to steal people's goods, and to even steal people's lives. God is not pleased with that. If you're involved in that type of living, I urge you to turn away from it. Repent of your sins. Ask God to forgive you and start to live a better life to please Almighty God. Because whatever you do, if you die in your sins, you will account for me, you will pay for it by being away from God forever and ever and ever and ever. Some folks say, oh, what are you talking about? After this life, when we are finished here, we are done. Yes, your body rots, but your spirit lives on forever. The real you lives on forever. And where will the real you live? With God or away from God? If you did not repent of your sins and try to live by the principles enshrined in God's word, you have no part in God's kingdom. Your only other part is with the devil and his angels, reserved where God has reserved constant eternal damnation and fire for them. Eternal torment, because he rebelled against God. And God said, there's only one God. I am God, all by myself. There is none like him. Those who are idle among us, we are to warn them. Idleness is not productive. There are a lot of people, young men who don't want to work, and young ladies. They like to live and sponge off people. They have health and strength, ability. Go out and get a job. Be self-employed. You can look for something that your hands can do, that you can do, and get employed. Stop being idle. We are to encourage those who are afraid and timid. We are to help those who are weak. We have to be patient with everyone. God has patience with us. We ought to have patience and be patient with other people. You know, sometimes we hear the talk, I'll do you just what you did to me. I'll do you back what you did to me. The Bible here says, make sure that nobody pays back wrong for wrong. So if somebody does you wrong, you're not supposed to go and take vengeance and pay them back. Vengeance belongs to the Lord. God said, vengeance is mine, I will repay. And if you trust in God, in His own time, in His own season, He'll take vengeance for you. And you yourself will be sorry for those who wronged you when you see what God allowed to happen to them if they don't repent. So we have to always try to be kind to each other and to everyone else. Wow! We have to always exhibit love and kindness to each other. And that will make the world a better place. If we do that, we won't have all these murders, all these killings, all these executions, all these unsolved murders, people dying, just being cut down in the prime of their life. We live in, these people who do these things, they live in pure hate, not love. And they need salvation through Jesus Christ. And even if they have done evil and they come to the Lord, He will forgive them. The Apostle Paul killed many people, thinking he was doing the right thing because they were following the wrong God. When he was struck by the Lord on his way to Damascus to go and kill more people, then he said, Lord, Lord. He called Jesus Christ the Lord. He realized then that he was doing wrong. And if you are doing wrong out there, go about killing people, stealing, robbing, stop it. Cease from doing evil. Turn your lives over to God. Try to do the right. Try to walk in love. Love worketh no ill or no danger or no harm to its neighbor. If you love your neighbor, you wouldn't kill them. If you love your neighbor, you wouldn't burn down their house. If you love your neighbor, you'll forgive them when they do you wrong. I don't say you will wrap up close with them still, but you'll be wary and you'll be watching them, but you will still have a heart of forgiveness. And if it comes that they need good to be done to them, you will do it to them. That is how God made mankind. That is godliness. In verse 16, he says here, be joyful always. Pray continually. Give thanks in all circumstances, for this is God's will for you in Christ Jesus. You see? No matter what our situation is, we must always find a way to be joyful. We must always find a way to pray continually and give thanks to God in every circumstance that comes our way. At first it will seem difficult to do, but constant practice in the Word of God will cause you to accomplish God's will and walk according to God's precepts and principles. He says, be joyful always, pray continually, give thanks in all circumstances. Do you give thanks because God has seen you through? God is seeing you, and God will give you the solution. And God will provide for you. You may not know how, you may not know when, but He'll always come through for you. Always come through. God always comes through for mankind. And when He says your time is finished here, He takes you away from the suffering and the pain and the hardship and takes you with Him in eternal glory. Isn't that a glorious God? Say now, dare you choose to live in crime, doing evil to other people, and you're comfortable with that? Don't you have a conscience? God made each of us with a conscience to know good from evil. If you want to gain something, you want money, you want clothes, go and do it the right way and get a job. Do some job. You must have some skill. Each one of us is born with a certain skill or certain skills. And those skills can be used or are to be used to encourage us to make a living and to be a productive, fruitful member of society. Not to be a thief. Not to be a murderer. Not to be a killer. Not to be an assassin. No. To be a productive, fruitful member of society. One who would care for others and work in love. So don't tell me you can't find a job. So you have to steal and rob and kill. Don't tell me. you have never tried the right way. Today, as you hear my voice, turn your life around and try to walk the right way. Try to walk according to God's precept. Walk to please God. Walk in love towards the fellow men. Don't go about robbing and stealing. Somebody has a car, they bought a car, they took a loan, they work hard and they have a car. And you see it fit to hold them up, hijack them, shoot them, kill them, take the car and go with it. Somebody worked for all their monies and they have their monies going to the bank. You see it fit to have an armed robbery. All you plan to do is evil, 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 evil. You are the son of Satan by doing that. You're a child of the devil and no good lies in you. But God made a way for your change and your salvation through Jesus Christ. He made a way for a change for you. If you want to change, you have the power to change from evil to good. You have the power to change from doing a crime to doing the right thing. It's all a matter of choice. We continue in First Thessalonians chapter 5, verse 18 says, "Do not put out the Spirit's fiery. Do not put out the Holy Spirit's fire. Do not treat prophecies with contempt." Some people, when they hear a prophecy, oh, they are always prophesying and praying their God. They are not praying their God. They are doing God's will. And if a prophecy is true, it will come true. If it's false, it will not come true. You have to try the spirits and try the prophecies and see what is happening. He says, "Test everything. Hold on to the good. Avoid every kind of evil. And may God himself, the God of peace, sanctify you through and through. And may your whole spirit, soul and body, be kept blameless at the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ." So here we are exhorted to walk in love, forgiveness. Do good to our brothers and our sisters. Do good to those that hate you and persecute you. Do not return evil for evil. Trust in God, and God will help you. So you base your life and try to do the principles as is explained in the Word of God. Have a great day. God bless you. I trust that you find comfort and peace in the Word of God. I'm Pastor Agnes Williams of Agnes Williams Ministries, discoursing with you on principles enshrined in the Word of God. Have a great day.
No weapon.